Good afternoon, and let me thank Express Computer and Indian Express for giving me this opportunity to be here. And as Mr. Shivshankar mentioned, about second generation challenges. So as a second speaker, I'm going to be talking about the second generation challenges. We have now moved into the cyber physical biological space, which is globalized. And in this globalization era, international trade, investments, and technology are connected inseparably within the global supply chains. Globalization of trade and investments means that no state can manage its economy independently. Transnational threats such as terrorism exist. Internationalization of culture and communications using technology is taking place. The development of weapons of mass destruction and their commodification is taking place. In the 80s and 90s, you could see there was a separate global economy and cyberspace, and then they started merging. And today, the global economy and cyberspace are merged. The cyberspace has overlapping social, technological, psychological, and economic domains. The intersection of all these four domains demands availability and accessibility, being open and shareable, and safety and security. There was a time when most of the data was with the federal government or at the state and local government. Today, most of your data is residing with private operators and businesses. In the past, it was the technical community which dominated how designs for systems would be. Then it started that the internet players or major commercial internet players also had a say in this. But today it is the end users who are demanding what the design should be. So you are seeing a sea change of where we are, and as also Mr. Shivshankar mentioned. We are living in a VUCA world. I hope you all know what is VUCA, right? Volatile, uncertain, complex, and ambiguous. But what does that mean from a security perspective? Volatile because there's a large attack surface, there's emergence of new vulnerabilities with no patches available, there's phishing and spear phishing emails. It's uncertain because do you have an idea and a list of where your assets are? Do you have an idea about where all your data is residing? Do you also have an idea about who are the good and bad actors on the internet or in the organization or department? So there's a lot of uncertainty. From a complexity perspective, the implementation of new technologies in existing infrastructure brings about complexities. You are forced to introduce new technologies as and when they emerge. Look at the supply chain itself. It's a very complex mesh. Do you have an idea about who is supplying what and what do you get as the end product? Ambiguous, because the large number of technologies that you've deployed, they provide a lot of logs, reports, etc. But how do you know which is noise, which is genuine threat, and how do you create intelligence out of all that? So, there are certain game changers as we move into the digital economy and society. You have the global economy, whether there will be a breakdown or collapse, or will it increase resilience? Mr. Shivshankar talked and touched upon governance. How do you adapt to change, or will you be overwhelmed by it? Potential for conflict, regional instability, and technology. Will technology solve the problems, or will it create new ones? If you look at the digital economy and society, there are 7 core elements and there are 29 sub-elements. And the trends are very clear. You look at the infrastructure that needs to be provided. Everyone wants access and connectivity. We talked about capacity building, the skills that are required in this new era of digital economy and society and knowledge economy. Will we be able to provide those skills, or will we actually create new digital divides? That is something we need to think about. Innovation, Will it bring about that transformation that we are looking at? FinTech is a good example. And can we build the trust and mitigate the risks? So if you look at a study by the European Commission, they say that by 2020, the value of personalized data will be 1 trillion euros, which is almost 8% of European Union's GDP. As this trend grows, there will be increasingly growing conflict between the value of data and individual privacy and consent. So today, cybersecurity is a fundamental enabler of digital economy, and hence we need to have trust and confidence in the digital infrastructure and devices. With that as a backdrop, the government had a vision for Digital India, a program to transform India into a digitally empowered society and knowledge economy, built on three key areas: digital infrastructure as a utility for every citizen, governance and services on demand, digital empowerment of citizens. Today, India and Indians are dependent on digital infrastructure and on their digital devices. But the digital infrastructure and these digital devices are under attack every day. So what are these sort of attacks we're talking about? The cyber attacks that we're talking about, if you look at the World Economic Forum's last 3 years, top five global risks in terms of likelihood, you see data fraud and theft, you see cyber attacks continuously appearing in the last 3 years in the top five. And these cyber attacks have evolved from being nuisance behavior to cyber crime and theft to disruption and now moving into destruction. So what are the trends that we are seeing? The attacks erode the trust of customers. And I said trust was important. The cost of attacks have increased 52% over last years. The application attacks are causing the maximum damage. The primary goal of the cyber attackers is service disruption and infrastructure destruction. So we need to be careful about it, because if these sort of things happen, how are you going to provide e-gov services? If you look at the last quarter of last year, victims paid an average of over $6,700 as ransom. And it is touted that ransomware attacks will occur every 14 seconds in 2019, and a total ransom of $11.5 billion will be paid. Can we afford all these things? And these attacks are becoming more frequent and impactful. To give you a perspective about this, I think you have to understand the global damage which is caused by cyber attacks is estimated at $3 trillion annually. At the same time, when you look at the aggregate cost of natural disasters such as hurricanes, floods, wildfires, thunderstorms, earthquakes, all put together is only $306 billion. So which is more damaging? Just in the physical space, because you can see what's happening when hurricanes, floods, etc. come, and you do not see what's happening in the cyber attack. Don't underestimate the damage that they are causing. It is for this that the Government of India, in the Information Technology Act 2000, under the Section 70B, brought in CERTIN, the Indian Computer Emergency Response Team. And I have just tried to break it down into four different buckets to make it simple. The Indian Computer Emergency Response Team needs to respond to cyber incidents in a rapid fashion and monitor and prevent them, issuing alerts, advisories, vulnerability notes, etc., provide the necessary help, provide cyber assurance, which is basically fundamental processes required to manage operational risk and look at the technical safeguards, look at providing cyber intelligence in terms of understanding and knowledge as to who, what, when, where, how things are happening at a macro level. And look at cyber cooperation and collaboration, because in this world which has no geographies, where geography has become history, in the cyber world you need collaboration and cooperation, else you are not able to go forward. The interesting part is, I think there was a time when a lot of people said that cyber security is a cost, it's a compliance hurdle, it's a blocker for innovation, etc. But I think the people from cyber security field have done a fairly tremendous job, and I will say also the different certs have done a tremendous job. And in a recent Capgemini and IDC research report, it was found that 34% of the business executives perceive information security as a driver of competitive advantage or differentiation for their own businesses. And 32% perceive it as an enabler of business efficiency. So if you look at cybersecurity and if it is properly implemented, it will help from a competitive advantage and differentiation perspective as well as a business efficiency perspective. And in the same report, the perceptions for cost or compliance hurdle, blocker for innovation, etc., have gone down tremendously. So just to give you a little more on what we do at the CERT IN, or Indian Computer Emergency Response Team, in those four different buckets. Incident response, the challenge is, of course, one is when you have an incident and then how do we help you. But the challenge is, how do you first of all look at prevention and also look at proactive actions. So there are mandatory reporting of cybersecurity incidents by everyone to CERT IN as per the law. Otherwise there are penalties. Emergency measures for incident handling. And obviously coordination of the response activities. And with the trends that are happening, if you look at 2015, you had to look at coordination activities or response activities every 10 minutes. Now it is every 2.5 minutes. So you can imagine the volume and pressure that is on the people who are working in CERT IN. You also provide detailed incident analysis and investigation reports to the affected parties. Just to tell you how the penetration of ICT has been moving, and just look at the alerts, advisories, vulnerability notes. In 2017 were 276 that we published, and in 2018 almost double, 436. And that's why I said you have lots of vulnerabilities, no patches, you still need to look at your business running, etc., and what do you do. We provided guidelines for what are the roles and responsibilities of a chief information security officer. We formulated the cyber crisis management plan for countering attacks and cyber terrorism. And we regularly provide training programs for network and system administrators as well as the CISOs. So that's one bucket. In the other bucket, or cyber assurance, where the challenge is managing operational risk and technical safeguards, we have empaneled 76 security auditing organizations to support and audit the implementation of best practices, including preventive, detective, and corrective controls. We conduct cyber crisis management workshops on a regular basis, and we also conduct cybersecurity mock drills and exercises to enable the assessment of cybersecurity posture and preparedness. And we do these exercises at three different levels. One is where we give a vulnerable application for you to host, not in your production systems or network, and then we launch sort of dummy attacks for you to figure out whether you can detect, respond, recover, mitigate, etc., which tells you as to how good your processes are, how good your technologies are, how good your people are, and based on that, you can go back to your senior management and request for budgets, etc., if you need something. The second level is, in this sort of a scenario, we do tabletop exercises where we give hypothetical situations and we request everyone to now react to the situation as and when it is unfolding. So they are in a position to see how they have to coordinate outside their organization and within their organization. The first one is within the organization, the second one is within and outside the organization. And the third level that we do is for the senior management and the board, where they get the awareness of what is the challenges of cybersecurity, why it is important, why it is critical, how it creates that differentiation and competitiveness for their business, and how they can support the CISO and the rest of the team and the rest of the organization from a security cybersecurity perspective. So we've carried out some of those, and the boards and senior managements have been very excited about those scenarios and how they've been unfolding and what they need to do. And it's very good to see their perspective as to what they were thinking and what the actual realities are. So that's the second bucket. The third bucket is the intelligence, where we're looking at the challenge of situational awareness and speed to detect and respond to intrusions on digital infrastructure and digital devices. So we launched the Cyber Swachhta Kendra. How many of you are aware of this, Cyber Swachhta Kendra? I just see a couple of hands, the others are not. So this is a botnet cleaning and malware analysis center, where this is in a public-private partnership model, where we work along with the industry, with the ISPs, with the academia, and then CERT-IN, where we start looking at which are the devices which might be infected with bots and providing free tools to get them cleaned up. We only know the IP, we do not know who's sitting behind it and who this belongs to. That's where the ISP play a role by informing the citizen or the organization that this belongs to you and you are seem to be infected. You can go to this portal and download the tool. The industry provides the free tools which you can download and clean your systems, and the academia keeps looking at research of new things which are coming up and what needs to be done so that they can work with the industry and provide the tools. And a great example of that was during the WannaCry outbreak, where we were able to immediately talk with the academia as to this is what is happening, these are the indicators of compromise, etc. They were able to come up with some immediate patches and solutions which were provided to the industry by late afternoon, early evening, a patch was available and people were able to download things and safeguard themselves. An example of that is we've seen, though this is a citizen-centric service free of cost, we've also seen various organizations. Today we have more than 200 organizations who are connected with us on this for their public-facing IPs to let them know whether any of their devices are infected. And we've seen in one of the major industries, if you see the graph here, it's almost a 90% reduction in botnets and more than 75% reduction in vulnerable services. In terms of vulnerable services, because what are the doors which are open where malicious actors can get in and create havoc. The other one which we, why this was important was because today if you see the internet traffic, 52% of it is only bot traffic. So where are you getting that? If you're choked with your bandwidth, that is the reason. It might be within the organization, maybe outside, and that's why this is critical. And this is one of the few projects which has been implemented across the globe, and it's not there in many countries. So we should be feeling proud about having implemented this. The other one that we launched was the National Cyber Coordination Center for Situational Awareness. And this is providing detailed or macro level view for various agencies to work together, come on the same platform and work together, where they can start seeing what actions they have to take based on their mandate. For example, if you look at which are the compromised IP cameras connecting to malicious command and control servers, to take action on those. Look at who's scanning your assets, which are the ports which are being scanned. For example, if you look at the pie chart of the different ports which are being scanned, it shows 28% to be RDP scans for a particular situation and a particular day. Okay, and if you go into details, you realize that 85% of ransomware infections have been traced to RDP. So if people are scanning your assets for RDP, obviously they are waiting to find out if they are open, they can start injecting things. So you have to be very careful, and this is the details that we provide on a daily basis to organizations who are connected with us on the Cyber Swachhata Kendra as well as on the National Cyber Coordination Center. The next one is, the next bucket is about coordination and collaboration in terms of partnerships and relationships for trust building. And we work with the government, public, private organizations, service providers, law enforcement agencies, product and security companies, sectoral certs, international certs, individual users, academia, regulators, as well as participation in multilateral and bilateral exercises, drills, dialogues, etc. So today we have more than 14 MOUs with different international certs, and we work very closely with all the different ecosystem partners that I've listed here. So if you look at the role of the government, it is to provide a widespread e-gov services by ensuring that it can defend itself from attacks and disruptions. It can safeguard the social and cultural fabric of the society, incentivize the industry for good cyber practices, and understand risks, increase trust in technology, and improve the services. CERT-IN is trying to do its small bit in this journey, and I hope we are in a position to help you all and help your business grow forward and be more competitive. Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, would you like to engage in conversation with Dr. Behl? If yes, can I please see a show of hands here?
That's studious Shika asking you all, and there are no questions. I think they're scared of the knowledge that you already have.
All right, I think maybe over networking break or in the subsequent hours of the evening then.
Thank you.
Dr. Behl, thank you very, very much.